Dear Arthur Effendi, please turn on your camera so we can start the lecture. Okay, good morning. Before we start our lecture today, I would like to discuss something about your midterm exam. Okay, I already sent the grade to the system, so you probably could see it. If it's not, then probably in a few days. There are some common mistakes that made by student. First of all, let me share the screen. So if you look at the okay, if you look at the so if you look at the flow chart, okay. Basically, the event here is the class registration system, or you can call it KRS if you like. Okay, the pre-KRS here can be seen as external. Okay, so the whole process here is the KRS process, or class enrollment system, or class registration system. Who are the actors? Obviously, students. That's the most obvious one, and nobody missed that. The second is actually the lecturer, because if you look at the class registration system, you'll see that there is a class and also the schedule. Who determine the class and schedule? It's actually the lecturer. Okay, so I was offered by the accounting department just before this semester began. When and what kind of class I would like? Oh no, they actually assign me classes. So I got two classes of accounting information system, B class and C class. And then the department asking me when I want to teach the B class, when I want to teach the C class. So I determine the schedule. So there are at least those two actors. And also you can imply that administrative bank perhaps, okay, because it's there, but at least you have students and lecturer. Okay, that's for the midterm exam. Okay. Now, I'll move to the next topic, which is assignment. Okay, usually the second half of our lecture, the accounting information lecture, will require you to create application using Microsoft Access. Okay, and that's usually done for half semester. So I'll give the assignment at the beginning of the first lecture today, actually. And then I will ask you to submit it by the last lecture. Okay, but looking at the previous experience, that would not be an ideal situation for now. So I'll break down this assignment into smaller assignment. So one big assignment, I'll break it into smaller chunks of assignment. And it starts with this, that data. Okay. So based on business process you have described in the previous assignment, you need to design tables with attributes and primary keys required for recording all the data in that business process. Okay. So for your previous assignment, you already described, you already draw a picture of business process, sorry, diagram of business process. Now you need to design tables that will record the data. Okay, so it's up to you what kind of data you will record. Okay, but there is a minimum requirement. For example, if you describe sales system, then there should be information about the buyer, information about the seller, and information about the product that being sold. Okay, that's why if you look at the midterm exam, I ask you to identify the events, the actors, and the resources. Okay, the resources would be the data that being recorded. Okay, so and also each group, this is a group effort, need to prepare a presentation for next week. So you present your tables, and I'll give you my inputs about the tables. Should you add more tables? Should you delete one table, or you should modify the existing tables? I'll let you know next week. Okay. So once we finish the tables, then you can create the tables in Microsoft Access, so on and so forth. And then we will, you will need to design input form. You will need to design information, things like that. Okay, but we will discuss that when the times arrive. But for next week, you need to create tables. Okay, I would suggest you to use Microsoft Access to create tables if that's possible. Otherwise, if you are uncomfortable using Microsoft Access at this point, you can use tables in Microsoft Word, or you can use Microsoft Access. Microsoft Excel to create tables. Okay. The most important thing is you create tables. By tables, I mean more than one. You need to show the attributes of the tables and also the primary key. Okay. So draw that and present to the class next week. Any question about your next assignment? Faith, Joshua, David, Kaisepo?
Yes, sir.
You didn't submit midterm exam. Why?
I'm really sorry about it, because I'm in NTT and I'm fixing just a disaster.
Okay. In that case, you need, I'll give you a chance to resubmit your assignment. Okay.
Yes,
But you need to write me a letter explaining that and send it to my email.
Yes, sir.
So send your assignment and also email explaining that to my email address. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Can you do it by 5 p.m. today?
Yes, sir.
Okay, by 5 p.m. So if it's more than 5 p.m., I'll give you zero.
All right, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Any question about assignment? No? Okay, so prepare the tables with attributes and primary key. The primary key could be more than one, so that's for you to decide, and present your design next week. Okay, now, today we will start to discuss the transaction processing system and how each transaction will be processed using accounting information systems, what kind of document to process things, and so on and so forth. And we will start with revenue cycle. So let me see. After I explain to you about the revenue cycle, I will also explain to you some trick that usually done by salesperson in order to manipulate the system. This is based on real example. This is it really happening. Okay, my wife worked for a company and she's the sales manager, and a lot of her staff did this trick. Okay, but I'll explain to you later. Okay, so revenue cycles. Can you see the slide? Is it visible, the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so revenue cycle. Revenue cycle is when the company generate revenue by selling something. It could be product, it could be service, but examples in this lecture will be using products. Next week, we will discuss expenditure cycle. This is where the company expense or buying something. This week, the company, we are taking the stance of a seller, so we sell something. Next week, we will take the stance of buyer, so we buy something. Okay. So revenue cycle and expenditure cycle, both cycles have mirroring activities. It's like the two sides of the same coin. Okay, but I'll explain to you later. Okay, so revenue cycle is a recurring set of business activities and related information processing associated with providing goods and services to customers. Once the product has been delivered or service has been done to customer, we collect their cash payment. Okay, so after we deliver the product, after we did our services, we expect the customer to pay in cash or any other cash equivalent. So the primary external exchange of information is customer. We take the stance or we view all the process from the seller point of view. Okay. So information about revenue cycles will flow to other cycles, to expenditure and production cycles. This is about products inventory. Okay. If it's trading company, it will go to expenditure cycles. If it's a manufacturing company, it will go to production cycles regarding the product that we will sell to customer. Human resource parallel cycles. This is especially for salesperson, could be paid based on commission of as percentage of the sale. So for example, if I sell 1 billion rupiah, I get 1% of that as my commission. Or this is more common that a salesperson in many companies were tasked with certain sales target for each month. And if they achieve or exceed that target, they could get bonuses. Okay. So, and there are plenty of, variation of this commission or bonuses scheme. If you achieve the target, you can get this person. If you exceed by certain percentage, you get another incentive. If you sell certain product, you get incentive. If you sell a combination of certain product, you get incentive. Okay? So that depends on the company, what they want to push the sales. Okay? General ledger and reporting function for reporting, obviously. Okay, so what's the primary objective of revenue cycle? The primary objective of revenue cycle is provide the right product in the right place at the right time for the right price. So the right product, it is rare for a company to sell only one product. So they usually sell a series of product. And then they could offer a combination of their products to customer. And it is not unusual a customer wanted to buy a certain product. So the right product need to be provided to the customer. If I want a car with red paint, I should get the car with red paint, not green, not blue. If I want Sedan, I should get sedan, not minibus, not SUV. Okay. In the right place, customer might want their product that they order or buy delivered to certain location. So we need to deliver that to the right location. Customer may have more than one business location, so we need to deliver that to the right place. If the customer want the product delivered to Jogja, it should be delivered to Jogja, not Semarang, not Surabaya. Okay. At the right time, if the customer need it today, it should be delivered today, if it's possible. Okay. Or if you promise to deliver the product within 48 hours, you should deliver the product within 48 hours. A lot of customers depend on a company's ability to deliver the product on time, because they need to use that product for their own production. So for example, if it's a car company and they need steel for building the body of a car, they need the steels being delivered on time and the right place. And for the right price, salesperson usually negotiate a price with customer, and company usually provided salesperson with certain discount, certain sales program to sell the product to customer. You may have the published price 10,000 rupiah per unit, but then if you buy more than 1,000 unit, you can get discount 10%. So instead of paying 10,000 per unit, you pay only 9,000 per unit. So, and you deal that with the salesperson as a customer. Okay, so the right price needed to be delivered to the customer. Otherwise, they will be very angry. Okay. So, what the decision should be made? Should we customize the product? Should customer could add or change anything in their product? When you go to a fast food chain, for example, it's usually we could not customize the product. Okay. In the old days, Burger King, for example, their slogan was "Have it your way." It means that customer may add or it's not possible to add, but they may want to change something in their burger. I used to ask for Burger King order not to have onion and pickle or gherkin, because I hate those. Okay, so it's just beef patty, cheese, sausage, and also vegetables. That's it. No onion, no pickle. I don't like it. But nowadays, it's very, I don't think Burger King accept that anymore. Okay, so what happened is I received my burger with onion and pickle, so I have to throw them out myself. Car, you can ask car with certain color. You can ask with certain features. Yeah, you can change that if you have the money, obviously. How much inventory should we carry and where? You know that this is Ramadan, okay? So a lot of grocery stores beefing up their inventory with groceries that usually needed for Ramadan, like for iftar, you know, something sweet, and then later the department store will prepare for Idul Fitri with new clothing, new products, things like that. Okay, so how much inventory should we carry and where? How should we deliver the product? Should we deliver ourselves with our own delivery vehicles? Or can the customer pick up the product themselves? Or we ask somebody else, the third party, to deliver our product? Okay. How should we price our product? Can we give customer discount? Can we give them sales program like if you buy 10, you'll get one free, okay, or any discount? Should we give customer credit? Can they buy now pay letter? If so, how much? And on what terms? How long? Is it 2 weeks? Is it a month? Is it the credit limit should be 100 million, 1 billion? How much? Okay. And how can we process payment to maximize cash flow? Or activities in revenue cycles: sales order entry, shipping, billing, and cash collection. Okay, sales order entry will be done by sales department. Usually, it's under marketing. Some company have marketing and sales as one department. Some other company separated marketing and sales into two different department. Okay. I'll show you later at the end, almost at the end of the presentation, the structure of all the function or department that involves in revenue cycle. So what are the steps in sales order entry? First, take the customer order. Second, check the customer credit if they want to purchase on credit. Check inventory availability and respond to customer inquiries. Okay, so these are the data flow diagram for that. Okay, so let's take into more detail. Customer order, take customer order. Okay, customer order could be received by having customer come to our place, come to our store. It's getting rare that customer send email, by phone. You probably already use this capability with some of the fast food company. You call them and ask them to prepare some food and send it on a website or using application in your mobile phone or tablet. GoFood perhaps, or GrabFood, or Tokopedia is fall into this kind of order taking. Or if the buyer is another company and they buy in bulk, not retail, then a salesperson will visit them. Okay. So for example, if you are company like Carrefour or Superindo, then other companies like Unilever, Coca-Cola will visit your store and offering the product that they sold. Okay. So the order from customer will be recorded in a document called sales order. It could be paper, it could be electronic. If you order something from Tokopedia or Bukalapak, the sales order will be on electronic form. If you go to a restaurant and you have to write down your order in a piece of paper, that also sales order. Okay. Okay. So what information should be on sales order? First, item numbers order, or the item you want to order. What item? What product? How much or how many quantities? On what price that you agreed with the salesperson? Okay. And who is the salesperson? Remember, salesperson are usually having target, they have to achieve that sales target for certain period of time. So the salesperson name who process that sales order, who receive that sales order, should be mentioned. Okay. Now, next week when we discuss the expenditure cycle, we will see another document called purchase order. That's document to purchase something from the customer. In the practice, in industry, that if you work as salesperson or if you buy something as a buyer for a company, sales order and purchase order are usually the same document. So the sales person will not give you sales order, then you as a buyer will not give salesperson purchase order. They are usually just one document. But for sales, it calls sales order, but for the customer, it will call purchase order, but it's same document. And in practice, if you go to the Word, you will see that a sales order usually called as purchase order or PO. Okay, so if you see somewhere in social media, open PO for something, that means that they accept order. Okay. As much as possible, we need to reduce error in our sales order. And as much as possible, ask the customer to fill out the sales order themselves. So if you order something through a website or application, Tokopedia, Gojek, GoFood, then it is you who fill out the sales order as customer. Okay. Or if you go to the restaurant and the waiter take your order, the waiter will then confirm your order by repeating your order to you. Okay, that's to reduce human error. So if it's a sales order, usually, especially with a big order in the magnitude of millions or billion rupiah, both salesperson and customer should sign the sales order. Okay. So what if the order came from telephone, you know, the customer speaking? You could record the conversation. Okay. There are plenty of recording devices for that. So if it's disputed, then you have evidence on the order. Okay. You know, with application, for example, you can ask, you can, as customer can enter their order directly to the system rather than the salesperson. So then the next active step in sales order entry is to check the customer credit. Okay, there are two activities here. So credit sales should be approved before the order is processed. If the customer wants to purchase by credit, it should be approved. There are two specific authorization for the, two authorizations for this. First, general authorization. This is for existing customer. They already have credit limit and they want to buy below their credit limit and they don't have past due balances. They don't have any unpaid purchase in the past. Okay, credit limits vary by customer based on past history and ability to pay. The more frequent you buy, the higher value you buy, and also the more disciplined you pay for your purchase on time, then you will get bigger credit limit. But from time to time, especially closing to festive season like now in Ramadan, some companies may give their customer, especially for business customer that buy in bulk, temporary credit limit increase. So for example, in the normal time, Carrefour have 1 billion rupiah credit limit, but near or during Ramadan and near to Idul Fitri, Carrefour may get increase in credit limit to 2 billion. Okay, so they can buy more and then sell more because usually consumption nearing the festive season like this always increase. Although how much increase during this pandemic season, I don't really have the number, but it's always increased compared to the normal one. So during the Ramadan and also Idul Fitri months, perhaps the customer will can get temporary credit increase. And then after the festive season pass, they can return to the normal limit. Okay. So with general authorization, it's usually done by system, by computers, just if I have 5 million rupiah order and I still have 10 million credit limit, then it's approved immediately. But if I have 10 million credit limit, but my order is 20 million, then it's automatically rejected. Okay. Specific authorization. This is for customer who are new, never had credit limit before, or have past due balances unpaid purchase or placing orders that would exceed their credit limit. So, for example, if I have a good credit history, but my limit is only 10 million and I want to buy 12 million, the company might give me a temporary increase in credit limit to exceed my credit limit. Specific authorization is done by credit manager, and credit manager is under finance department, not under marketing or sales. So it's different department. This is a separation of accounting duties. Okay. Then, after we clear the credit for the customer, we check the inventory availability. Okay. You can check, usually it appears on the quantity on hand, how many or how much inventory we have in warehouse. And for those who are in warehouse, which are in warehouse, sorry, how much or how many already committed to others. So it's still available, but it could not be sold because it's already ordered by other customer. If the inventory is not available in warehouse, then you could look at probably if there is new inventory coming on order or on production. Okay, so we don't have that right now, but the production will be finished by 2 a.m. and it will be available. So you can say that to customer, or you can ask customer to wait for a few days. Okay. Some companies will have a limit or will have a gaps between the order and delivery. Coca-Cola, for example, between the order and delivery, they will have 48 hours gaps. So if the order is on Monday, it will be delivered on Wednesday. If there are enough units to fill the order, then we complete the sales order. We close the sales order, the customer will be notified, and the quantity available filled in the inventory will be reduced. So if we have 1,000 inventory and then we close sales for 200, then the available inventory will only be 800. The following department need to be notified. Shipping, so they can prepare to send the product to customer. Inventory, so they can prepare the product that ordered by customer, and billing for asking the customer to buy. To pay. Okay. If there's not enough product to order, it will initiate back order. It means if it's manufacturing company, it will tell the manufacturing or production department to create the product. If it's a retail company, asking the purchasing department to buy more product. If you ever knew how to buy a new car in Indonesia, you probably often hear the term indent. Indent means you need to order the car, and the car company or the car sales will order the production department to create that product. Okay, so that's basically back order. Therefore, accurate inventory record needed for customer that can be accurately advised of their order status. So, for example, if you have inaccurate inventory record, it could be troublesome. Say, for example, you have 200 products in the warehouse, but in the record, you only show 100. So if a customer want to buy 150, physically it's available because you have 200, but the record only show 100. You can reject that order because you only have 100 on record, but the customer want 150. Okay. Similar to if it's too many. You have 200, but the record show 300, and then the customer buy those 300. But physically, you only have 200 in the warehouse. Then after you receive the order of 300, you check to the warehouse. Whoa, it's only 200. You have to cancel the order. Okay, so put very, very unfortunate for the company. So unfavorable for the company. So we need to have careful and accurate inventory records. Okay. Okay. So that's it. Apart from that, customer may ask, but not ordering. They may ask products before they may ask something before they make a purchase, or they could ask the status of their purchase order. Okay. And it's very essential, although it's not technically a sales, it won't be recorded on any accounting report. You will not see this on balance sheet or profit and loss report. Okay. But it's very important to respond properly and in timely manner to customer inquiry. If they asking about products, okay, and responded properly, they may buy. For example, if you go to, you know, a store, shoe store, for example, and you asking, do you have this in black? Do you have this in size 40? And nobody answer your question, I can guarantee that you will not buy in that particular shoe store. But if somebody actually responding to your inquiry, do you have this in black? Okay, I'll check in the warehouse. And then they came up with, I'm sorry, we don't have that in black. Still, there is no sales, but at least you will get a good service. Okay. We will discuss this more detail in management information system course. Okay. Okay. So that's it. Yeah, we finished the order. Okay. Now it's time for shipping. Okay. In shipping or sending the product to customer, there are two major steps. First, we pick and pack the order. We pick the product and we pack the product to be ready for shipping and also actually shipping the order. Okay. So shipping and picking and packing usually done by warehouse, and shipping department also have their own department, or it could be under one function. And it's usually under the manufacturing or operation. So it's different department from credit, different department from sales. Okay. It's pick and pack. Picking and packing. So once the sales being close, I mean that you finalize, the shipping department will receive information about that sales. They will receive information in form of picking ticket. Picking ticket, taking the information from sales order, sorry. What the information in picking ticket? First, which product to pick and what quantity. And then after they gather enough product that sufficient according to the sales, then they will pack that for shipment. Okay. Could be speed up by technology using barcode and so on and so forth. Some company even using robot to pick up the appropriate products. Shipping the order, okay. So shipping department will receive the product already ready to be sent in the packaging. They will count the physical inventory and compare the quantities indicated on picking ticket and quantity on sales order. It could be the same quantity, it could be different. If it's different, why? Probably because that order, for example, a customer ordering 1,000 units, 500 will be delivered, will be sent or shipped from warehouse A, the other will be shipped from warehouse B. Okay. Or perhaps the customer will receive 500 now and another 500 next week. Okay. So That could be done. So the shipping clerk will record sales order number, the item numbers ordered, and the quantity shipped. Okay. And then it will create packing slip. Packing slip is information, list the quantity and description of each item in the shipment, so it will be attached to the shipment. Multiple copies of bill of lading. Bill of lading is legal contract that defines responsibility for good in transit. With bill of lading, if you see any shipment, you will see the bill of lading. It identify the carrier, the source, the destination, and special shipping instruction, and who pays for the shipping. Is it cash on delivery? Is it paid by the sender? Is it paid by somebody else, or it's free shipping, for example? The carrier who actually delivered the, or shipped the product, where it come from, and where it's go, the destination. Okay. Okay, so what's the major shipping decision? Some company maintain a fleet of trucks, right? Like some fast food company, they have their own delivery armada with motorcycles or any others. Some companies, other companies, they increasingly outsource the delivery to third party. Why? It's to reduce costs and allow company to focus on core business. So if you as the company want to deliver the product yourself, then you need to have transportation vehicles, either motorcycles, pickup truck, pickup trucks, or any other vehicles to deliver the product. You have to pay people to drive that vehicles. You have to pay for maintenance of that vehicles. You have to pay for fuel of that vehicles. Okay, and you have to find a way to maximize. For example, you have 10 trucks, but all the time you only use 5. The other 5 is not working. That's a shame. That's unacceptable in business. So a lot of companies now, they will use third-party delivery company. Courier company like JNA, Tiki, JNT, and any others. Okay, internationally, probably FedEx, the post office, okay, UPS, DHL, TNT, things like that. By using third parties, we can reduce costs. We only pay the amount or the price for delivering our product. If we send 1 ton, we pay for that 1 ton. If we send 10 units, we will only pay for that 10 units. Okay. So when we select third-party carriers or delivery companies, we need to monitor their performance, on-time delivery, and condition of merchandise delivery. If they promise, like JNA, they have overnight service, is it really overnight, or it takes 2 weeks to reach destination? Condition of the merchandise, is it in a good shape or it's broken? Okay. Either way, we have to evaluate the carrier company based on these two criteria. Okay. Okay. Now, the shipping could be very tricky or complex when you cross the border of countries. Different country will have different regulation, will have different tariff, they have different taxation, and they have different custom. Custom in Indonesia, bea and cukai. Okay. So for example, once that I met during my research, I met this handicraft exporter in Yogyakarta. He often export his products to Australia. Australia is one of Australia is a country which the strictest custom regulation in the world. Okay, so whenever this person want to send handicraft product, mostly made from wood or bamboos, so he stuff a container box, and then he sealed the container box tightly, and then He will ask somebody, a company, to, it's called fumigation. So they will pump gas, chemical gas, into the shipping container to kill bugs, mold, and fungus that probably this will be dangerous in Australia. Australia is very, very strict about this. They will. Once when I went into Australia, I brought along a small shampoo with in a box made from coconut, sorry, made from banana leaves, dried banana leaves. My shampoo can go. They allow my shampoos to come with me, but they confiscated the banana leaves container because they said banana leaves may contain viruses or bacteria that will destroy banana industry in Australia. Even within Australia, there is some places that when you enter that places, you could not bring any fruit from outside. You have discarded that fruit. Okay, so anyway, so this person have been exporting to Australia many times and succeed. He know all the drills, he know all the regulation, and never had any problem with it. So one day, this person received order from Scandinavian country. I can't remember which is probably Denmark. So he packed. He sent the product and using Australian standard, because Australian standard for fumigation is the highest in the world, and send it to Denmark. The problem is when it reached Denmark, Denmark custom sent it back. It was rejected. Why? Because the dosage for that fumigation chemical is too high for European standard. So with that kind of dosage, Australian call it normal, in European Union they call it poisonous. It's dangerous, it's toxic, because it's too high of the dosage. So if you have a cross-country shipment, then you need to understand the regulation about that. And also there are a lot of risks involving sending product overseas. You probably remember a few weeks ago that there was a blockage in Suez Canal because a ship stuck in the canal. Many years ago, a lot of shipment companies, cargo being hijacked near Somalia by Somalian pirates. You know, even one of Indonesian ship once being captured by Somalian pirates, and so Indonesian government have to send one of our warship to capture the ship back. Okay, so that's the problem. So you send the product and then we start the billing. Billing, there are two activities, invoicing and updating account receivable. We may bill the customer after the customer receive their order, not before. At the same time, fine. You can send your bill with the product, that's fine. But not before the product received by the customer. So for example, if you order food, if you order product and you haven't received the product, but you already have to pay for that, that's usually not, will not get along. Even with things like Tokopedia, when you pay in Tokopedia, you actually did not pay the seller yet. The money will be held by Tokopedia in escrow account. And it will only release to the seller once you said that, yes, I received the product, and yes, I'm happy with the product. Not before that. So you may bill the customer after they receive the product and happy or satisfied with the delivery, okay, not before. Invoicing, okay. With invoice, we need to accurate and timely bill. Okay. Billing, we need information from shipping department on how many product actually being delivered, what product and how many, and also the price. on that product and also any other sales term. Okay. So we send the customer bill or invoice, sales invoice, and the invoice will consist of these two basic information: the amount to be paid and where to send the payment or how to pay that invoice. Okay. It could be in paper form, it could be in electronic form. Okay. So and then the second activity is updating account receivable. There are two ways. So basic task, if the customer purchase something, they will get invoice, and once we create invoice and send it to customer, the customer receivable account will be debited, and when the customer make a payment, it will be credited. Okay, so there are two basic way to maintain receivable: open invoice and open balance. Open invoice and balance forward. Open invoice mean you create invoice, send it to customer, and then customer will pay by invoice. Whenever the customer make a payment, they have to specify for which invoice this payment should be. Okay. Then balance forward, rather than paying by invoice, customer will pay at once, maybe once a month, like electricity or phone, especially postpaid. You pay every month, not every usage. Okay, so for April, how many purchase that you made, you pay for that. For May, how many purchase you made, you pay for that. Okay, so that's balance forward. Okay. That's how technology adjustment. That's return. I will not discuss it then because you already, I assume that you already covered this in financial accounting. Okay. And then cash collection. Once the customer receive the invoice, then he or she or they will pay. Okay. The best advice for receiving payment is avoid receiving cash payment as much as possible. Cash is inherently vulnerable. You can miscalculate cash. You can easily misplace cash. You can lose cash easily. There will be counterfeit money. So the best way is to use non-cash payment, either using check, credit or debit card, or transfer, or any other non-cash arrangement. Okay. With cash is also risky. A lot of it happens to my wife. So once one of my wife's staff, a salesperson, receiving cash payment few hundred million rupiah. It was against the rule because the regulation in my wife's company where she works is never accept cash payment from customer. If customer want to pay, they have to go to cashier or make a transfer or use check or whatever non-cash equivalent. Okay. So what happened was the customer paying, giving the money to the salesperson, and the salesperson brought that money to the office to be given to the cashier. But just when the salesperson parked his car, a few motorcycle closing to the cashier, and he was robbed. The cash, few hundred million, was taken away. And that salesperson was fired. Why? Because he broke the rules. Never accept cash payment from customer. If the customer give the salesperson check, that would be fine. Okay. If the customer give the salesperson proof of transfer, that's not a problem. But cash, big no. Okay. That's why in certain department stores or supermarket, they open during the holidays until late night, and they receive cash payment. There is a service, if you ever saw any cars that usually fill ATM machine with cash, those cars also pick up cash deposit from businesses. And those companies usually already have methods to protect the cash. Okay. So as much as you do, avoid paying or receive cash payment. Okay, unless it's very small, you know, like maybe less than million, fine. Okay. So this is the structure, organizational structure for all departments and functions that involve in sales or revenue. So the marketing here, they will responsible for sales, takes customer order, you know, persuading customer to buy, things like that, and also customer service. Manufacturing here, they will responsible for picking up the products, packing up the product, and send the products to customer. Finance, here there are controller will be the one who create the invoice and also maintain the account receivable. And also there is treasurer, they have cashier that receive the payment, and also credit manager who create credit limit for customer here. Okay, so this credit manager who approve credit limit and also set credit limit. Okay, so that's the separation of function. Okay. Is there any question about revenue cycle? Okay, now, like I said before, I'll show you how to manipulate things. Okay. Let me start with this. Sorry. Okay, so just a moment, there's a problem with it. Close this. Okay. Can you see this? Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good, thanks. So, here's what happened. Suppose I pretend to be a salesperson. Okay, I get target for my April, 100 million. Okay. But by April 30th, I only had 75 million, so I still have 25 million from my target. And for salesperson, if they did not achieve their target, it's a bad performance. And if they continuously couldn't achieve the target, they probably will get demotion or even dismissal. They will get fired from companies for non-performing. Okay. Anyway, by 30th April. So if you look at your calendar, 30th April 2021 is on Friday. Okay. So what would I do? I would create a fictitious order from customer A, say 25 million. Okay, so it's exactly the same amount that I need to achieve my monthly target, 25 million. I create that order, and then I'll send the product. I ask the shipment to send the product by 5 p.m., knowing that customer A will be closed on Saturday and Sunday. So I'll send it Friday evening, close to their closing. So the product will arrive, the shipment will arrive when they want to end their businesses. Okay, so I I hope they will accept my shipment, okay, and deal with that later. Okay, so they accept the payment, they accept the shipment and deal with that later because they already want to go home for the weekend. Okay, so I send the product. The shipment department bring along the proof of delivery. The customer receive the product. And I close April by achieving my target, 100 million. Okay. So what happened the next business day? On Monday, May the 3rd, A opening their business, my customer, and then say, who orders this 25 million? We didn't, so return the product. Okay. So because it was written, I already have made target probably say 125 million because there will be 25 million written from April. I will start May not with 125 but with 150. So it's bigger than my actual target. But that's fine because it will be May problem, not April. For April, I achieve my target. Okay. So on face value, nobody actually being on disadvantage. I didn't steal money, I didn't steal anything. But this is not a good way. This is manipulating sales. Therefore, usually a salesperson will be recorded to make a sales when the customer actually make that order, product being delivered, and the customer being billed, the customer receive invoice. Okay, so to be counted as sales, the salesperson need to show that they have sales order, they have proof of delivery, receiving report by customer, and also invoice delivered to customer. If that is those document being present, then and only then the sales could be counted toward my target achievement. So if you are the boss, how to see this, how to prevent this? Okay, usually what my wife did was looking at the written report at the beginning of the month. And if you saw any of the salesperson have regular return at the beginning of the month, you should be very, very careful. Okay, because that salesperson probably, and I don't say that's definitely, probably they will manipulate system. Other way to manipulate sales, I create fictitious order, and because I have good relationship with customer A, I told A, please, I want to help me, do me a favor, keep this 25 millions of product in your warehouse. I will sell it later. Okay, so out of their goodness of heart, A receive the products. Okay, and then hopefully you can sell this 25 million. But a lot of times, those 25 millions could not be sold for various reasons. And remember, this 25 million counted as invoice for A. But since A didn't order it, they will not pay for it. Okay. So the other way to detect this manipulation is to see the overdue invoice. And then ask or it's not asking, confirming with the customer, did you order this? Did you make this order? Did you make this purchase? If they didn't acknowledge that, then that's probably fictitious order created by salesperson. Okay. And that's happened many times. Okay. Most of the time, the salesperson will be able to sell this 25 million before the invoice overdue, you know, so they can pay back the order. But also many times they fail to sell the product for various reasons, and then it become unpaid invoice and overdue invoice. Okay, that's it for today. Any question? Look, I told you about the manipulation, not to teach you how to manipulate, but someday you will work, and probably you will work as a manager or boss of a sales function. You need to be aware of this kind of manipulation, because it's happened. It's very, well, I don't say it's a habit, but you can find it easily. It happens. Okay, so as a manager, you need to be aware. Many times I saw a case where one salesperson did manipulation, did fraud, and the manager didn't find that out. The salesperson obviously get fired, but the manager also get fired, or at least get a punishment, severe punishment. Why? Because the manager should not let this happen under their watch. As a manager, it's a very poor reason that if your staff did something bad and your excuse was, "I didn't know." That's very poor excuse, and nobody will accept that as a reason or as a alibi or whatever. If you said that, "I didn't know," that's it. Your career is over. Okay. So what happened? You know, this is what my wife did when she found out that her staff did something like this. First, she will punish the staff based on the company regulation. It could probably a warning letter, it could probably suspension, it could probably dismissal, fire. Okay, and then she created report to the company and asking for internal auditor to check. It shows, although there is the manipulation, it shows that the manager knew that something fishy was going on, and he or she act upon it. Okay. You could not, I mean, with all the internal control, the best internal control in the world and everything, if you remember, fraud still could happen because of the person. Okay. And you could not prevent 100% a person to commit fraud. But as soon as you find it and you make an appropriate action, you'll be fine. Okay, so it was so many times my wife found out about this fraud, and what she did was punish the perpetrator according to the regulation in her companies, recover the loss as much as possible, and then asking internal auditor to conduct audit for that, and that's the right thing to do. Okay, so, but if somebody under your supervision commit a fraud, you didn't understand, and somebody else find that out, it will be bad for your career. Okay. So that's it for now. Remember, prepare your presentation about the tables for next week. Okay, so see you next week.